Good afternoon. The first item of business is the portfolio questions, and the first portfolio question this afternoon is health and social care. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. I call question number one, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government what specific training and continuous personal development GPs undertake to remain updated on developments in helping women through perimenopause and the menopausal stages of their life.
Minister Marie Todd.
Menopause is included in the Royal College of General Practitioners curriculum, which all GP trainees need to demonstrate competency of in order to practice independently as a GP in the UK. Training materials and aids are widely available to GPs to ensure that they remain updated on the latest developments in helping women through both the menopause and the perimenopause. The Scottish Government has recently commissioned NHS Education Scotland, NESS, to create a bespoke training package and framework focused on the menopause and menstrual health for GPs and others working in primary care.
Jim Fairley.
I'd like to thank the Minister for that answer. Having spoken to numerous constituents about their concerns and their experience of menopause, the experiences have been patchy and inconsistent in the information and help that they've been offered. Some have been completely dismissed as being either too young to be suffering from perimenopause or told that menopause is not a disease, so therefore just getting through the process until it is unbearable is probably the best course of action. I could cite numerous examples of very poor outcomes for women who have felt completely dismissed about the changes they are experiencing in their lives. Dr. Louise Newson, as a practicing GP herself, had to set up her own menopause clinic because no one seemed to be able to give her the correct treatment for her. So can I ask the Minister to please look at what GPs in Scotland are doing to advance the understanding and care that perimenopause and menopausal women are going through so that they get the individual person-centred treatment that suits their specific needs?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. Indeed, women have told us very loudly and clearly that they don't always get the support that they need when they're seeking help for menopause symptoms. And in fact, that's one of the reasons for my having women's health responsibilities specifically in my portfolio. It's also why, through the implementation of the Women's Health Plan, we intend to build a basic understanding of menopause amongst all healthcare professionals. That will include awareness of the symptoms of perimenopause and menopause and the intermediate and long-term consequences of menopause, knowing where to signpost women for consistent advice and support. We've actually created in the last year a menopause specialist network, which has been established, and it meets regularly and supports primary care teams by providing access to a menopause specialist for consistent advice, support and onward referral, leadership and training. So I would expect to see improvements.
A supplementary, Cara Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is right that we need to consider all ways of helping women through perimenopause and the menopausal stages of their life. However, to spearhead the policy and advocacy work in this regard, we must appoint a women's health champion here in Scotland. The First Minister told the Chamber in June that an appointment would be made in the summer. Charities are now saying that this deadline has been missed. Can the Minister advise if the Scottish Government have made an appointment, and if not, why not?
Minister.
Let me assure the member that that appointment process is almost complete, and I would expect to be able to make an appointment, an announcement around the appointee very soon. We, of course, that was indeed, as I have reiterated many times, a medium-term commitment in the Women's Health Plan. We have met all of our short-term commitments in the Women's Health Plan, and we are making progress on many of the medium-term commitments that we made.
A supplementary, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, I want to ask about the accessibility of HRT supplies. While trying to access my own medication, I have faced barrier after barrier and inconsistency after inconsistency. I've seen the protocol. It's nothing more than a scrap piece of paper. So let me ask, what action is the government taking to stop menopausal women and perimenopausal women from being bounced around the primary care health service so that they and we can access the support and treatment that they need in a timely and straightforward manner?
Thank you. And before I ask the Minister to respond to that, I would highlight that the question on the business bulletin relates to the issue of specific training and CPD. So if the Minister could respond to the question in that light, that would make the question supplemental to the question that actually is on the business bulletin. Thank you, Minister.
Okay, so absolutely, I'm happy to do that. There is prescribing guidance available to assist prescribers from multiple sources, including from NICE, and they revised their menopause prescribing guidance in March this year, and that can be found in the usual places, the clinical knowledge summary online. I would have to say Scottish Government ministers and officials are unable to comment on individual cases of prescribing practice because it's NHS boards and healthcare professionals locally who have responsibility for service delivery and patient treatment, and the decision about which treatment to prescribe is made on the basis of an individual clinical decision by the prescriber, taking into account the patient's condition and medical history. I wonder if my colleague is actually also referring to the issue around shortages in HRT, which are a UK-wide issue, the supply of medicines and any associated shortages, as I'm sure she is absolutely aware, is reserved to the UK government, and we will continue to work with them to seek a lasting resolution and to press them to work closely with the affected companies to address that particular problem as quickly as possible.
Thank you. And before moving on to question number two, could I please make a plea for more succinct questions and answers? Thank you. Question number two, David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is giving to primary care services as they recover from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
We are committed to increasing investment in primary care services as they recover from the pandemic. Priorities, of course, include the delivery of the extended general practice multidisciplinary teams to ensure patients are seen by the right person at the right time, and funding for that has increased from £155 million to £170 million this year, with 3,222 members of multidisciplinary teams already in post. We're also supporting the recovery of NHS dentistry by investing £20 million to allow dentists to see more patients, with a particular focus on children and tackling oral health inequalities. Staff recovery and wellbeing is also critical to renewing our NHS, and support includes the National Wellbeing Hub and a confidential staff helpline.
David Torrance.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Kingham Surgery in my constituency has been without full-time GPs for several months now. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what assistance the Scottish Government can give to resolve this issue and provide reassurance for my constituents?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm obviously happy to reach into the local health board and health and social care partnership, but as I've already referenced, we're putting significant amounts of investment into general practice, particularly into general practice recruitment. We obviously have a target to increase the number of GPs by 800 by 2027. We're making good progress with 277 GPs already recruited. Our trainee recruitment fill rate this year was, GP trainee recruitment fill rate this year was 100%. Again, an improvement on last year and very successful indeed. So I will reach in to local stakeholders in relation to the issue that David Torrance references, and I'll write to him with an update.
And supplementary, Sandra Gohani.
Thank you. The lack of specialist clinics, the waiting times for surgery, delayed discharge and the stagnation of patient flow through hospitals has led to desperate patients turning to GPs, and we are overwhelmed and patients are angry. Support from pharmacies is vital through independent prescribing to reduce GP workload. What data does the government collect and have that tells us how many prescriptions are done per pharmacy per day to ensure this government funding is effective, because the Pharmacist Defence Association does not believe it is?
Cabinet Secretary.
I will actually. I have received correspondence in relation to some of those concerns that have been raised and written back to a number of members of the Scottish Parliament. What I would say is that pharmacists play an incredibly important role to help to alleviate those pressures right across the system, whether they're in acute sites, whether they're in community pharmacies, whether they're in GP practices. And actually some of the money that I've just referenced in terms of the MDT staff members that have been recruited, pharmacists and pharmacy technicians have made up a significant proportion of those additional MDT staff recruited. For example, if I looked at the number of pharmacists, pharmacy technicians, for example, we had 38.3 in our GP practices in 2018 and now have 2022. In terms of the specific question around the prescriptions, I will look into that. I will write back to the member with further detail. But I want to place on record my thanks to our pharmacists up and down the country, whichever setting they're in, for the incredible work that they do to help alleviate the pressure on our NHS and social care.
And supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
I'm very glad the Cabinet Secretary recognised the importance of pharmacists. It is very worrying to see the growth in closures of pharmacies and the impact this has on carers and patients. The Pharmacist Defence Association has highlighted how the owners of these pharmacies are all able to claim non-activity-based payments after closure, enabling some of them to enhance their profitability at the expense of patient safety. Will the Minister outline what range of actions health boards can take to deal with these closures, given that the present arrangements have failed to stop them? And does he intend to add additional actions to discourage further closures?
Cabinet Secretary.
So if my memory serves me correct, and I'll correct the record if I am wrong, of course, I think I may have written to Jackie Bailey on this very issue, because she's written to me with those concerns that both she and Dr. Sandesh Gohani have just raised. And in that, of course, I reference the fact that the closures are very few, but that's not to say that they don't have an impact. Even if they are few, they may well have an impact. So it is, of course, for those local health boards to look at the contracts that they have. And, of course, if anybody is in breach of those contracts in terms of pharmacy provision, then action can be taken. In addition to that, there's a number of asks that have come forward from members. I think in my response back to Jackie Bailey, I've said I will look at those and, of course, update Parliament in due course.
Question number three, Mercedes Vialba.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the findings of the 2021-22 Health and Care Experience Survey in relation to patient satisfaction with GP services.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think we'd say that, of course, any reduction in that experience is regrettable, but I hope that the context of that particular survey is well understood, and I'm certain it is understood by Ms. Vialba, but also understood by members right across the chamber. And that context, of course, was the pandemic. Guidance issued to GP practices not to treat patients face-to-face unless clinically necessary, social distancing introduced into practices. And while there were more remote consultations, electronic booking systems were used less as existing systems could not screen for COVID-19 symptoms. So what we will do is continue to invest in GP practices. We want, of course, people to have access to those services in similar levels as they did pre-pandemic. And of course, the Health and Care Experience Survey is a vital tool for us to get that direct feedback from patients across the country.
Mercedes Vialba.
The Health and Care Experience Survey results show that patients are dissatisfied with GP services at medical practices which were put out to tender in Aberdeen earlier this year. I've previously shared the testimonies of patients at Old Aberdeen Medical Practice with the Cabinet Secretary. In a letter to me today, the Cabinet Secretary stated that his officials have communicated his expectation that GP practice monitoring should resume in Aberdeen as soon as is practically possible. But what about reported declining standards that are already reported to have happened in recent months? Will the Cabinet Secretary request that NHS Grampian sets out a plan to address the issues which have already been identified by patients, such as those at Old Aberdeen?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Ms. Vialba raises a fair point. Some of the scores in the Health and Care Experience Survey for the newborn practice, for example, were far beyond acceptable. They were not acceptable. Some of those scores, they were far below the Scottish average. Some were above the Scottish average, we have to recognise too, but some of the scores, particularly in relation to accessibility and the ability to get an appointment within 3 working days, those scores were particularly low. So I will ask my officials to reach in to local partners to determine the improvement plan that those practices will be putting in place to give a reassurance about the improvements, the actions that they'll be taking to see an improvement in that patient experience.
A supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does Cabinet Secretary agree that much patient frustration lies with the often archaic appointment systems employed by some GP practices? I've had constituents, ill people, call 100 to 150 times to get through, if at all, some practices. What steps can the Scottish Government take to ensure that systems whereby folk know where they are in a telephone queue are implemented as standard?
Cabinet Secretary.
Very good point raised by Kenny Gibson. There's no doubt at all that a lot of the frustration, understandable frustration for members of the public, is when they have to phone up a GP practice and it's a game of Russian roulette and whether or not they get through. Now that is, I would hope, the minority, and I don't doubt the minority of cases. So I take what he says on board, and I just had a discussion, in fact, this morning about the fact that every single GP practice should have that pre-bookable appointments in place. So I accept what Kenny Gibson says, and I'm happy to keep him and other members up to date as we progress that matter.
Supplementary, Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Freecombe Health Centre in Angus scored 95.46 positive score in the Health and Care Experience Survey. It was the highest score across Tayside. But difficulties recruiting GPs to the surgery meant it closed earlier this year, moving 3,000 patients elsewhere. That was another huge blow for rural patient care. The Scottish Government committed to a £20,000 golden hello to help fill rural vacancies. Why, Cabinet Secretary, is this simply not working?
Cabinet Secretary.
Particular issues with that particular practice, and it was raised with me by the local constituency MSP at the time, and rightly, of course, these matters are taken forward at a local level. But the member's right, we do actually have a number of incentives in place to make GP practices in rural and remote areas more attractive. The Golden Hello Scheme, the GPST bursary, of course, the ScotGem programme, which has just seen its first cohort graduated. So I'm hoping all of these issues, plus, of course, the work that we're doing on the back of Sir Lewis Ritchie's report, I hope all of these matters, these issues taken together, will begin to see more and more people, more and more of our doctors, more and more of our GPs take up those roles in remote, rural and island communities.
Question number four, Jamie Green.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the latest alcohol-related death statistics.
Minister Marie Todd.
Nobody should die as a result of alcohol consumption, and my thoughts go out to all affected. We're working with various organisations across Scotland, including ADPs, to address this issue. That includes piloting an innovative managed alcohol programme in partnership with the Simon Community Scotland, commissioning Public Health Scotland to review alcohol brief interventions, consulting on a range of potential alcohol marketing restrictions in Scotland, and fully evaluating minimum unit pricing. We support the principles of the right to recovery, and these will be embedded in the National Care Service, enabling everyone to access the treatment that they need.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Minister for that response, and I share her comments. Every loss of life is tragic, be it to drugs or alcohol. They are really Scotland's second national shame alongside our drugs crisis. The reality is that Audit Scotland are very clear about the scale of the cuts that were made as far back as 2014 to frontline alcohol services. That's why in my region, alcohol-related deaths are up 10% in the last 4 years. That's why right across Scotland, you're 5.6 times more likely to die of alcohol-related disease if you live in a deprived area. Can I make a plea to the Minister and the entire front bench of the government? Please listen to those on the front line who are desperately in need of support. They need help, and it's simply not there for far too many. Will this government double down, and I really mean double down on its efforts, to tackle alcohol-related problems in society, properly fund them, properly resource them, given their notable lack of absence in yesterday's programme for government?
Minister?
So I absolutely agree that alcohol and drug-related harms are vitally important public health issues in Scotland. That's why we established a national mission to improve and to save lives. And at the core of that is ensuring that every individual is able to access the treatment and the recovery that they choose. Alcohol is a priority for the Scottish Government. Our alcohol and drugs teams work closely with each other. They share knowledge around what works and on ways to reduce the impact of addiction, as well as routes through to treatment. Alcohol-related and specific deaths, as the member says, are disproportionately higher in deprived communities. And that's why we continue to take a whole population approach when it comes to reducing alcohol consumption and the risk of alcohol-related harms. And this, in turn, will drive reductions in alcohol harm in our most deprived communities. We are also, as a government, taking action to improve the conditions which drive alcohol harms, reducing poverty and inequalities, providing good quality, affordable housing, and enabling the best start in life for our children. I have to say it many times, though, it does feel like we're working with one hand behind our back in terms of how we give with one hand and the UK government takes with the other.
And supplementary, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In light of this tragic public health emergency, can the Minister advise whether the Government intends to introduce an alcohol harm prevention levy on alcohol retailers to help fund alcohol prevention activity and these much-needed support services?
Minister.
So certainly, as I've said before, I'm willing to consider all suggestions in how we tackle alcohol-related harm. The work streams that we have at the moment are many and extensive, and I would expect to deliver results. So I'm looking forward to seeing the evaluation on minimum unit pricing, which I think will be the most extensively studied policy that we've ever passed in this Parliament at the time we come to review as a Parliament whether it should be continued. At the same time as that, we'll also be looking at whether we have an appropriate minimum unit price. Of course, that was introduced, it will have been introduced more than a decade before, and I think it's timely that we review that. We're also looking, as I said, at alcohol brief interventions, those conversations that might open up and help people to consider and understand that they have an alcohol problem, where they can be used most appropriately, and how we can maximise the impact from that. And of course, the alcohol advertising. We still, as the figures show, have a profoundly unhealthy relationship with alcohol in Scotland, and we need to shift that culture. And I think that tackling alcohol advertising will absolutely be part of that.
Question number five, Mark Ruskell.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the proposed national treatment centres for NHS Tayside and NHS Fife.
Cabinet Secretary.
The NHS Fife National Treatment Centre is a £33 million project. It will see the creation of a state-of-the-art facility hosting three operating theatres, a supporting inpatient ward and associated outpatient facilities. Construction at the site began in March 2021. It's well underway. Assuming there's no unavoidable delays, the project is in course to complete construction in October of this year. The first patients treated in January next year. The business case for NHS Tayside National Treatment Centre is under development following a project pause in March 2020 during the pandemic. The proposals are being refreshed to meet current and future demand and to ensure that they meet our net zero carbon ambitions as well. An update on the opening date will be provided in due course.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's response to that question? We are still in a situation where one in nine Scots are waiting more than a year to receive essential treatment, so they do need hope right now that things are going to change. Could the Cabinet Secretary clarify what the focus of these treatment centres in Tayside and Fife will be, and also what an estimated impact that these will have on tackling the backlog of elective surgeries and procedures, and any comments he can make about how staff capacity can effectively support the delivery of these specialist services as the centres become operational.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think all these points are well made by Mark Ruskell. I cannot emphasise or overstate just how important and critical the National Treatment Centres are in order to help us with the backlog. You'll know the NTC programme was actually announced pre-pandemic, and it was important to get through what was a challenging position, which has been exacerbated by the effects of the pandemic. So they are critical, they are absolutely vital. They will, of course, be national treatment centres, so while, of course, those who are local to Fife, to Tayside, will of course benefit. There will, of course, be the ability to help and provide that mutual aid to other parts of the country. So I would say these national treatment centres are important for the localities that they're in, but also important for us nationally. Staffing for the Fife Centre in particular is very much well underway. There are no signalled issues or concerns around staffing the NTC, but I'm sure he'll appreciate that will be done over a phased manner as the NTC opens and becomes fully operational.
Thank you. Before calling question number six, again, I would make a plea for succinct questions and ministers present, succinct answers. Question number six, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the British Medical Association regarding the impact in Scotland of its guidance advising GPs to consider reducing their pensionable pay or retiring early due to changes in inflation and the way that these are used in calculations around GP pensions that reportedly leaves them liable for significant tax changes. Sorry, Charles.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the member and other members will be aware that the majority of the pension issues raised are reserved for the UK government, and I'm haven't had the opportunity to meet with the new UK government and health counterpart, but I have raised these issues before, and there hasn't been any flexibility on their position in this particular matter. Scottish Government and I have regular engagement, of course, with the British Medical Association, and the issue of pensions arrangements that affect GPs and NHS employees directly and via the NHS pension scheme have been raised with me. I have an introductory meeting with the new chair of the BMA later this month, where I'm certain the issues raised by the member will once again be on the agenda.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. In addition to other MSPs from across the Chamber, I recently met with the leadership of the local medical committee, who represent GPs and their practices within the NHS groups of Glasgow and Clyde area. And during that meeting, they highlighted the long-standing issue of pensions and how that they are leading some GPs considering leaving the profession early or reducing their working hours to avoid what the BMA has claimed that amounts to, and I quote, a pension theft. As our NHS continues to contend with the impact of the pandemic, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it's vital that the UK Government considers it changes to the tax-free annual allowance charges so that more GPs are not faced with this dilemma, which will only exacerbate the staffing issues facing general practice?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I agree wholeheartedly, and as I've said before, I've raised this issue with UK counterparts. There has been no flexibility in the position. There are actions that we may well be able to take, but it's, again, it's taking money from other areas within the health budget to try to mitigate a problem that the UK government are showing inflexibility on. So I will call on the UK government. I will look forward to the first meeting with the new Secretary of State for Health, I'm sure in very short order, and I will raise these issues with her again, and I'm sure the DFM, John Swinney, in his position, will continue to convey to the Chief Secretary of the Treasury our displeasure at these pension changes that have caused such difficulty for GPs and doctors right across the country.
And brief supplementary, please, Willie Rennie.
The Health Secretary does have the power to sort this. He could use recycling of pension contributions, which the BMA have put to him. It's available in Wales, in many parts of England, and Northern Ireland are looking at it. Why is he refusing to go down this route? It could release doctors back into the NHS to deploy them where they're needed. Why isn't he doing it?
So I'm refusing. It's actively under consideration, but I just go back to the point that dealing with this issue, the pensions issue at root cause, as opposed to having to take money out of other parts of the health budget and the Scottish health budget, would be preferable. So I'm pushing the UK government to make changes to pensions where they can, and that would help to alleviate some of that pressure. I'm very open to looking at a REC scheme. I know a REC scheme has been available, and that's why I'll be meeting with Dr. Kennedy, the chair of the BMA, later on this month, and of course I'll provide an update to members in due course.
Question number 7, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. The Scottish Government, when it last met NHS Orkney, and what issues were discussed?
Cabinet Secretary.
I met with the Board's Chief Executive and other senior staff when I visited NHS Orkney on the 16th and 17th of August.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. I've been contacted this week by a local GP in Orkney confirming that rising heating costs will cause significant implications for the health of his patients. He explains that, quote, stress caused by financial hardship will adversely affect mental health, and folk turning heating down or off will have negative physical impacts on health. This will create more ill health and further increase NHS workload. So while we clearly need urgent action from the new Prime Minister to address the cost of energy crisis, can the Health Secretary advise what additional support has been made available to NHS Orkney and other health boards to help deal with the increased workload and health impacts referred to by my constituent?
Cabinet Secretary.
Liam MacArthur is, of course, right. The cost of living crisis is a public health crisis. If people have to choose between heating and eating, either choice that they make is going to have a detrimental impact on their public health. And he is also right to make the point that our hospitals, our primary care services, our social care services will feel the pinch because of the rising costs of inflation and indeed of energy bills. So as the First Minister outlined yesterday in the programme for government, there is support that we are providing the public, particularly those that will be hit the hardest. I won't rehearse them due to the reasons of brevity. But what I would say is the meaningful action on this remains in the hands of the UK government. And therefore, we urge the new Prime Minister, the new Chancellor, to come forward with meaningful measures that will make a significant difference in the face of these rising energy prices, because only they have the powers to freeze or to cap those energy price rises. And I'll continue my engagement with NHS Orkney and other health boards in this regard.
And I can squeeze in question number 8 if I have succinct questions and answers. Question number 8, Gillian Martin.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how it's assisting GP practices in Aberdeenshire to fill vacant GP and health practitioner posts.
Cabinet Secretary.
We do offer a wide range of initiatives, specifically to attract GPs to rural areas like Aberdeenshire. It includes the Golden Hellos and bursaries for newly qualified GPs to take up posts in hard-to-fill rural locations. I would add that our new ScotGem graduate entry medicine programme
focusing on general practice and rural working is proving popular. The first cohort of 44 students graduating earlier this year from Dundee and St Andrews Universities.
Gillian Martin.
I thank Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The situation in my constituency is becoming critical, with five-year-old Meldon practice down to two part-time GPs and getting no applications for repeated GP post-advertisements over the last couple of years. Mintlaw practice has had to be taken back under control of NHS Grampian, with Central working behind it. Cabinet Secretary has already mentioned incentives in his response to me, but is the government considered developing any new inventive schemes that can further incentivise those who've left general practice to return and incentivise new graduates to base themselves in rural areas like mine?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I will ask my officials to reach in again to colleagues in Aberdeenshire in terms of local health and social care partnership, and of course the local health board in Grampian, around the specific issues that Ms Martin raises. Again, we do have a range of initiatives, and of course the ScotGem programme is still in its early days, but I've got no doubt at all that ScotGem programme will make a big and significant difference to the vacancies that exist in GP practices in remote, rural and island communities. But on the specifics, I'll ask my officials to reach in to local partners and provide an update to Ms Martin in due course.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on health and social care. And we will now move on to portfolio questions on social justice, housing and local government. I'll allow a very short pause in order for front bench teams to change position. Thank you. Thank you. And so we are now moving on to portfolio questions on social justice, housing and local government. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or enter the letter R in the chat function during the relevant question. I call question number one, Cocab Stewart.
Thank you. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government whether it will confirm when actions to remove cladding from properties identified as dangerous under the Single Building Assessment Programme will be completed.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson.
Thank you. We are taking priority action to address cladding safety issues, having expanded our Single Building Assessment Programme, which determines the safety risk from cladding systems on domestic blocks of flats from 26 to around 100 buildings. We expect the vast majority of buildings assessed to be found to be safe and continue to prioritise higher risk buildings. If cladding is assessed to be high risk, homeowners will be invited to discuss the assessment and agree actions required to make their buildings safe. We're working on agreeing the Scottish Safer Buildings Accord with the expectation that developers take responsibility for remediating their buildings.
Cocab Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. My constituents in Glasgow Kelvin can be reassured these projects continued at pace. When announcing the Scottish Safer Buildings Accord in May, the Cabinet Secretary underlined that a joint and collaborative approach was key to resolving the issue of unsafe cladding. Could she provide an update on how the Accord has been received by partners across the sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I can. We are working closely with our partners as we bring together all the stages of the Accord design. Our collaborative approach through engagement and information sharing will create this unique and what is quite a complex agreement. Homes for Scotland, as our key partner and representative body of the developer sector, strengthens this approach and are important to bring sectoral understanding and responsibilities to unlocking and resolving the issue of unsafe cladding for homeowners in multi-residential buildings across Scotland. And of course, I will keep Parliament informed when the accord is finalised.
Supplementary, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A series of freedom of information requests have indicated that 88 school buildings in Scotland still have flammable cladding of the same or similar type to Grenfell Tower. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe it is acceptable to be putting these lives at risk by delaying the removal of this dangerous cladding, and when will it be removed from all school buildings in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I'm sure Jeremy Balfour will understand, of course, it's the statutory responsibility of local authorities to manage and maintain their school estate, and we expect local authorities to deliver a safe environment for all school users. The responses gathered from local authorities showed that at the time, post-Grenfell, that there was not a large-scale problem across the school's estate in Scotland. And, of course, the Deputy First Minister wrote to local authorities to request assurance that the school estate was considered safe in terms of fire safety, and assurances were provided by all 32 local authorities. Jeremy Balfour will also understand that the focus of the government, as is the case in England and Wales, has been on those residential blocks where people are living, where there is unsafe cladding, because those are the buildings that are most at risk. That is the expert opinion, not just our opinion, the expert opinion. And that's why we focus our attention on tackling those residential buildings and the funding to make sure that we play our part in resolving those cladding issues as soon as possible.
A supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There are hundreds of buildings in Scotland with highly combustible, high-pressure laminate on them. Schools are some, colleges, unis, private schools, hospitals, prisons, hotels and care homes, as well as houses. And minutes of the Building and Safety Working Group said that following the pilot of 26 building assessments, a further 100 will be done in the course of a year. In May this year, only one single high-rise building in Glasgow is known to have been assessed. Given the scale of the problem across Scotland, do the Scottish Government recognise that much more action is urgently required to address the scale of the problem? And can the Cabinet Secretary advise how many buildings in Glasgow are believed to be affected, particularly given that the Scottish Government office in Glasgow at Atlantic Quay was recently revealed as one such building?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said to Jeremy Balfour, Pam Duncan-Glancy is also conflating two different issues here. One is about residential buildings where there are people living in those buildings, and that has been the focus of our attention, as is the case with the Welsh Government and the English Government, the UK Government, in order to focus on those buildings most at risk. That's what we're all doing, and that is the right thing to do. And of course, we've committed £400 million in order to take that forward. The accord will help with that because it will mean that those buildings that can be assigned to a developer, then they will remediate that building and resource the doing so. That means that our resources will be able to focus on those buildings that have no developer associated with it. And that's where we're focusing our attention on those 100 buildings. The other buildings that Pam Duncan-Glancy referred to are public buildings, and we would expect, whether it's a hospital or a school, for those organisations, whether it's a health board or a local authority, to take the lead in making sure their buildings are safe. And she will be aware of the issues that are being looked at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital at the moment. That is the right and proper way to go about these things. They're complex issues, but the approach that I have laid out to Pam Duncan-Glancy is the right approach.
Question number 2, not lodged. Question number 3, not lodged. I call question number 4, Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what impact inflation, energy prices and interest rates are having on housing costs in Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the impacts of the cost of living crisis are being felt by all households in Scotland, including in Christine Graham's constituency, and are disproportionately impacting people on the lowest incomes, including renters and those without fixed rate mortgages. The key levers for tackling the crisis remain in the hands of the UK Government, and of course they must act now. But our programme for government set out yesterday the steps that we're taking within our limited powers. We're investing an additional £5 million in discretionary housing payments and extending the scope of the tenant grant fund. We're also introducing rent controls to strengthen tenants' rights and a temporary moratorium on evictions.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. Can I also welcome the announcement in the statement yesterday of emergency legislation to freeze rents across private and socially rented sector? But can I ask, for the many constituents that I have in Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale, who are concerned about mortgage payments as interest rates rise. What interventions, if any, given a lot of this is reserved, are open to the Scottish Government to assist them?
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, can I welcome Christine Graham's identification of the emergency legislation as quite a significant intervention. But she does raise an important point about those on mortgages who are struggling. Now, there is a support fund available, I'm happy to write to Christine Graham, that provides the ability for people who are struggling, and these are people who are on low incomes, so it's not all mortgage holders, but those who are on low incomes, who are able to access that fund that can convert a mortgage to rent, or indeed a mortgage to shared equity. Now, we are looking and reviewing that at the moment to see whether we can do make that fund more available to support people. But lenders and advice agencies are aware of it, but I'm happy to write to Christine Graham with that information.
Supplementary, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. House prices are rising at a faster rate in rural areas, 13.5% in the Borders alone last year, as more people seek a rural lifestyle post-pandemic. South of Scotland Enterprise have identified that lack of affordable housing as the biggest barrier to attracting the workforce we need in the area. So does the Cabinet Secretary accept that the Government needs to review the target that equates to just 10% of new affordable homes being built in rural communities, or that demand will continue to outstrip supply, driving up housing costs and prices further?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can say to the member, of course, that we have been focusing very much on the needs of housing in rural and remote Scotland. That is why, of course, we're bringing forward a plan that will address the needs within rural and remote Scotland, looking at some of the barriers and also the timelines it takes to get a housing development off the ground, and looking at how we can remove some of those barriers. We're making a significant investment in the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, £3.6 billion over the course of this Parliament, to deliver 110 affordable homes by 2032, many of which will be in the members' area. So we will continue to do that, but we're always looking at ways that we can make that money go further, working with local partners to make sure that we deliver as many affordable homes across all of Scotland.
Question number 5, Douglas Lumsden.
Scottish Government what further support it will provide to local authorities for the provision of accommodation for refugees in Scotland in light of reports that suitable housing has been significantly reduced as a result of the super sponsor scheme.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the first point to make, of course, is that immigration asylum systems are fully reserved to the UK Government, and whilst local authorities continue to support resettlement schemes by offering accommodation and support in their areas, it's the Home Office that's responsible for the design and operation of resettlement schemes and the UK asylum system. Of course, refugees who have been granted status following an asylum application have the same rights to access housing as anyone legally resident in Scotland. Since the Ukraine war, under our super sponsor scheme to ensure displaced people could travel here safely and immediately, the Scottish Government has provided direct provision of accommodation and support, and we've also made £11.2 million available to local authorities to support this work.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer, but it's clear the houses aren't there. Aberdeen City Council last administration launched the city's largest council house building programme seen in decades. Last month, the new SNP Lib Dem administration froze four big developments which would deliver over 500 new council homes in the city, with the SNP leader citing budget pressures. Will the SNP Green devolved government get their act together, give Aberdeen a fair share of funding, and allow Aberdeen to build the new council homes required that can be used to welcome people to the Granite City?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't think the Tories are on strong ground talking about council houses at all, given the sell-off of tens of thousands of them under their watch over the last few years. So let's look at the situation in Aberdeen. I have provided all local authorities with the assurance over 5 years around the Affordable Housing Supply Programme investment. We expect all local authorities to come forward with their local housing plans in order to meet local need. But he linked this question with the issue of Ukraine, and I can tell him that Aberdeen City Council have been working extremely hard to come forward with proposals in order to help with the settlement of Ukrainian refugees, and if perhaps he had better communication with his local authority, he would know about some of those very important plans. I suggest he gets in touch and brings himself up to speed.
Supplementary Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much. Also, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it's somewhat ironic that while the Scottish Government is doing everything it can to support refugees, taking 18% of the Ukrainian refugees in the UK Tory Government is hell-bent on flying other asylum seekers out to Rwanda to deter them from actually settling here?
Cabinet Secretary.
The irony never ceases to amaze me, Deputy Presiding Officer, and Stuart McMillan makes a very, very, very important point. And, of course, we are doing what we can with the new Scots Refugee Integration Strategy, trying to support people to settle and integrate. And, of course, on the Ukraine programme, we, as the First Minister set out yesterday and the Deputy First Minister set out, almost 16,000 people have arrived with a Scottish sponsor here in Scotland, representing 18% of all UK arrivals, the most per head of any of the four nations. If only perhaps other countries could step up to the mark as well.
Question number six, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it had done on the potential impact on the sale price of new homes of its proposal to introduce new building standards to prohibit the use of direct emissions heating systems in new builds from 2024.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
I'd like to begin by referring the member to the answer to question SXW 10120 that was provided on the 25th of August this year. Research cited found that the installation of zero emission heating systems ranged from £2,000 to £5,000 more than gas boilers. Although these costs are highly variable, they depend on a range of factors, and importantly, they do not represent predictions for the costs after the 2024 change. The sale price of a new building is, of course, determined by individual developers and takes account of a wide range of variables related to building construction costs and local housing markets. Heating system installation costs typically have a smaller impact on prices than other factors.
Liam Kerr.
Yeah, I thank the Minister for that answer. I'd also like to refer to that parliamentary question, which didn't answer my question, rather like his answer there. The Minister admitted to me in that installing zero direct emissions heating systems from 2024 will cost up to £5,000 more per home. Now, in 2019-20, the last year before the pandemic intervened, the private sector built more than 16,000 new homes. So if Mr Harvey's rule had been in place, up to £82 million would be added to construction costs. So I wonder, Minister, what impact do you think adding £82 million to construction costs will have on families and first-time buyers' ability to afford a new home?
Minister?
Well, I'm sorry that Mr Kerr didn't choose to listen to the answer that I gave, which explicitly said that I was not making a prediction about what the cost of zero-emission heating systems would be after 2024. He suggested that I have made that prediction, and I haven't. Everybody within the industry is clear that we need to scale up not only the production of this kit, and many of the jobs, really valuable jobs doing that work, will be located here in Scotland, but also the capacity of the industry to carry out those installations. We're working with the industry to build that capacity, and that is expected to reduce the costs over time. Very clearly, all political parties have committed to the legally binding climate targets, which cannot be met without ambitious action on zero-emission heating. And I wish, for goodness sake, that the Conservative Party would actually start getting behind the actions that the Scottish Government is taking, which will make sure that we not only hit those climate targets, but do it in a way that benefits the cost of living and the economy in Scotland.
Thank you. And I would hope to be able to call both questions 7 and 8, but I would need to have succinct questions and answers. Question number 7, Alex Riley.
Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how many houses it estimates needs to be built to tackle the current housing waiting list in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which at least 70% will be available for social rent and 10% will be in remote, rural and island communities, and we'll invest £3.6 billion in this parliamentary term towards the delivery of more affordable homes across Scotland, with £30 million of that investment supporting the continuation of the Rural and Islands Housing Fund.
Alex Riley.
children trapped in temporary accommodation in Scotland is at its highest levels on record, up 17% in 1 year. Families in central belt of Scotland are being offered housing in the north of England because of a lack of housing in Scotland, and according to Shelter, 130,000 households are on waiting lists for social homes. Shelter have written to the First Minister and are calling for an emergency action plan that will buy and build 38,500 social homes by 2026. Will the government make housing a national priority, and will the government bring forward a costed national emergency plan so that we can address this unacceptable blight on our country? It makes economic sense and it is the right thing to do.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, affordable homes and affordable housing is a national priority, which is why £3.6 billion is allocated during this parliamentary term. That is a very, very clear commitment on our part to build more affordable homes. Now, Alex Rowley talks about a very important issue of temporary accommodation, and he mentions Shelter. And of course, I've asked Shelter, who have accepted to lead an expert group and head up an expert group, to look at what further solutions we can bring to tackle temporary accommodation, because he's absolutely right. There are too many families, particularly families with children, in temporary accommodation, and therefore it is one of my key priorities to target, and Shelter will help us in doing that work. I should point out that there are 20 local authorities out of the 32 that have managed to reduce the number of people in temporary accommodation since last year, but there is more work to be done in reducing the numbers in temporary accommodation, and that's exactly what we are determined to do.
Thank you, and I will now have to move directly to question number 8 because we are really running out of time, and I would ask for brief questions and answers. Question number 8, Ruth McGuire.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the increase in the number of children in temporary accommodation as reported in the annual Homelessness in Scotland statistics.
Cabinet Secretary.
So, as I just said, I'm very concerned by this increase. I am aware that the impacts of the pandemic are still being felt by local authorities, and they're also facing challenges meeting some households' needs, and that's reflected very much in the backlog of households waiting for settled homes. But the figures are unacceptable. And as I said in the previous answer, I've discussed solutions to temporary accommodation pressures with housing conveners, and I've also asked an expert group chaired by Shelter Scotland and the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers for an action plan, and I'm expecting the initial recommendations to be delivered by the end of the year.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Empty properties left in disrepair are a blight on neighbourhoods and could be providing much needed homes to family and children on waiting lists. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the progress of compulsory sale orders, and will the Scottish Government consider the proposal for compulsory rental orders?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Ruth McGuire makes an important point, and we are committed to modernising the compulsory purchase order process to make it clearer, fairer and faster for all parties, and to support the delivery of projects that are in the public interest. Compulsory sales orders are being considered as part of this. Any new powers, of course, would need to be compliant with the European Convention on Human Rights, and compatibility with existing powers need to be carefully considered, and this includes any proposals for compulsory rental orders, but happy to keep the member updated of progress.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and that concludes portfolio questions, and there'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.